Well, it is the last day, and I know that we have traveled over quite a bit of geographical territory and over chronological territory. So we're going to finish up with what for me is a bit of a new research interest, in that I have been looking at 18th century folk practices sort of by accident. I got interested in a Cumbrian poet who I discovered by accident when I was trying to track down a book that got lost in my family's inventory from the 19th century. I knew that the book was actually a set of magazines that had been bound, knew they had jokes about music, so I was like Googling to see if I could figure out what it was that we used to own that had 19th century music jokes, because I'm a musicologist. But instead, I tripped upon this poet named Ewan Clark. You've never heard of him. Like, not even most biographical dictionaries have heard of him. He published two books of poems, one in 1779, one in 1805. He died in 1811 at age 77. And he was of the nostalgic poetry tradition. He was writing, he was one of the early contributors to dialogue poems in dialect. So he was writing Cumberland dialect poems, and then he would do the sort of standard English version as the next poem in the publication. So you can kind of look at the local language, and then you can look at standard English and go back and forth. So kind of interesting. He also, he's a bit of a rat's nest. Little bits of this and little bits of that and little bits of something else. He's a major resource for folklorists who work on history of games, because he likes to talk about what little boys did. Well, why was he writing about little boys? Because he was a schoolmaster, and so he wrote about what he knew, and he captures things like boys chasing, playing chasing games and doing whittling things. But he also has some things where he talks about the cultural practices of adults. His second book, The Rustic, takes the life of a peasant, essentially a yeoman farmer, and goes from babyhood and the ABCs through senescence and the families gathering at his bedside at the moment of death. And all along the way, you get these various parts of Cumberland tradition, including weddings. So being a good scholar, I fell down that rabbit hole. It's been 2 years now, and I'm going to talk a little bit in the sort of later part of class today about some of what I found out about wedding practices, which I got interested in because Ewan was talking about them, but now I have 109 records, and I will share some of that information with you. But like any good musicologist, I'm also going to use today to sort of sum up where we've been this, this term. We're actually going to start a little bit with a funeral or something that purports to describe what should happen at a funeral in a document that purports to be a part of a last testament. So it is not. Never read the press and believe what you read unless you're cross-checking what your genre is. So we'll look a little bit at what was a satirical entry. It gives a couple of nice details about 18th century burial practice. Then we'll move from that into weddings, and in particular what I am going to call the bidden wedding, because that's what Ewan calls it. But which goes by a variety of names and sums up a variety of folk practices. My version of that is sometimes you get your best information when other people are making fun of you. So we'll be looking at some of the satirical entries in newspapers at the time, talking about those country fuddy-duddies and the things that they are doing in order to celebrate weddings, and then ending with a little bit of pictorial and dance evidence. So a nice little bit of all of the flavors of things we've done. So let's look at death. The so-called codicil to the last will and testament of James Clegg Conjurer. I just want to pause on that a moment, because when I first tripped across this, reading through, looking for something else, which is how you find the most interesting stuff, a conjurer. Okay, so I had seen announcements of funerals for magicians, and here was this thing, a last will, and so I started into reading it. And it got kind of interesting very quickly. And so figured we would walk through it a little bit. This is actually authored by a fellow named Tim Bobbin, who publishes his works under the name John Collier. That just sort of sums up the 18th century bibliographic process right there. He's writing as James Clegg. His real name, given name, is Tim Bobbins. His dad was also Tim Bobbins, and he's publishing under a different name altogether. Which way do you want to list him in the bibliography at the end of the book? Heaven only knows, but I usually do cross references. So this is actually someone who was trained as a weaver. And in this period, it's the rise of the factory worker. So the introduction of factories at the start of the 18th century became transformative, particularly in Cumberland, which is, when you're looking at England, Cumberland is up here. It's the uppermost left-hand corner. When you go across the Cumberland border northward, you're in Scotland. So we're right up by Hadrian's Wall, cuts through this area. And it is, the big city is Carlisle, which is not a big city, so that pretty much sums up Cumberland. Cumberland is interesting because it starts off with yeoman farmers. Yeoman farmers own their own property, so it's one of those carve-outs in England where we talk about the oppressive lords who have all of those people who work their land. And then there's Cumberland, which is too poor for the local lords to care whether they own your property. And so there's a kind of cottage industry of economists looking at the Cumberland farmer as a model for modern economic independence. They owned their own property. If they improved it, they got to keep the things that they got from those improvements. And so when the weaving factories come in, it sort of changes the local landscape, because instead of going from practical serfdom into a paid wage at the factory, you're going from I keep what I make to I am beholden to a boss. So when Dickens comes through this territory, he talks about how depressing the factories are, because Dickens always thinks that factories are depressing. But in fact, he's capturing a little bit of the spirit of this period, in that the industrial wages were not always as generous as they looked to be on the front end. So in Wigton, which is the town that I have been focusing on, you start the century with two factories. You end the century with more than 20. They come and go, but there are about 20 of them. And there is another industry of calico printers. So first you make the cloth, then you stamp the colors into it. And people are starting to die from all the toxins. So it is not a happily ever after story. The river gets polluted, the people start dying off much, much earlier. So in the middle of the 18th century, your life expectancy, once you got past childhood, so once you were over 5 years old, you could expect to live to about 70. By the time you get to the turn of the century, you could expect to live to about 58 or 60. Bad news. Industrial pollution is a real thing. So here is a guy who starts working as a weaver, tosses it up, and decides to make his life as a schoolmaster, which was a more stable wage. It was not a good wage, but it wasn't as bad as working in the factory. At least that pattern of schoolmasters who start out in the industry and move out to teaching is a thing in the north of England. You find them by the multiple dozens, and bless his heart, some guy at University of Newcastle did an index to the 2,000 plus schoolmasters in the north of England, so you can tell all sorts of things about them socially. That I have read that book is sort of one of the weird details in my life. So John Collier has become a schoolmaster, just like my friend Ewan, and he turns to writing humorous rhymes, and it is his poetry for which he is mostly noted. However, he is part of a very generous family of Clegg's. Clegg's abound in the neighborhood. He is then naming people in this story that are people named after people he knows, even though they're not meant to capture the people that he knows. And you'll actually find that John Collier comes up later in the article. So he cites, he writes the will as if he were citing himself as a second person. Those 18th century authors, they were something. All right, so he is interested in making the arrangements for his funeral. 60 of my friends, or at best acquaintance, and also 5 fiddlers, because we must have music. They're all to arrive promptly. We're going to be very descriptive in this will. We're not going to have any women. We're also not going to allow men to wear aprons. So you shouldn't come dressed in your day clothes. You should come dressed up to my funeral. And we're not going to allow tobacco or snuff, because that leads to bad behavior, and we don't want any sneezing. Then again, we're going to have a general allotment of foods, and this is going to be one of our themes today. We really like cakes and ale, so I don't think of cake and beer going together, but that is the sort of standard accoutrement for happenings in Cumberland in this period. And your average housewife is going to be proficient at baking, and she's also going to be her own brewmaster. So the ale that is usually served is either something that you have brewed yourself or something that you've purchased off a neighbor, usually by giving them a bunch of eggs. So it's a bit of a barter economy in this period. However, we're going to do 62 cakes, and then we're going to invest a lot of money in ale, because after all, you really want to have a good time at a funeral. I'll do this. All right. So the executors are charged with getting the body ready in roast meat clothes. So he's to be dressed nicely. He's to be then laid on a bier and carried out with a sprig of rosemary. You remember rosemary, that's for remembrance. And so the idea of the symbolism of the ceremony is part of what we are baking into this legacy, and then there should also be a cake. They shall all get together and drink a gill bumper, so we're going to be imbibing a substantive quantity. A gill is larger than beer stein, and we are going to play Britain's Strike Home while they're bringing me out and covering me. So Britain's Strike Home, it's a real thing. It's by Purcell, who is the sort of the central English composer of the century. And one of the things that I think is interesting is that they cite Purcell like he's folk music. So you get the same quality of reference, like you just name the piece. You don't mention that it's by Purcell. But then when you're doing your sort of tracking down, a lot of the tunes that they're referencing were either written by Purcell or borrowed by Purcell. We like the word borrow in preference to steal, because if a good composer uses music from somebody else, they must, of course, be making it better in some way. So Britain's Strike Home is actually a multi-stanza song that comes out of a mask, which is sort of a mini opera. And this mask, Bonduca, is what we'd modern day, we'd say Boudica. So she was the sort of Amazon-like figure who managed to fight off the Romans, and so that confrontation was the subject of this mask. Purcell writes the music. It's a bit repetitive, but we get some nice performances. So toggling out to my music sphere. Here we are.
Britain's strike home, revenge, revenge, our land is wronged. Britain's strike home, revenge, revenge, our land is wronged. Fight, fight and record, fight, fight and record your surging ruined songs. Fight, fight.
So it's a little AA BB structure.
Fight and record yourselves in good songs. Fight and record. Fight and record. Record yourselves in good songs.
Then you get the choir. And that also winds up going through the whole piece, AA, BB, and then you do it all over again for stanzas 2, 3, 4, 5. And so here is a little, if you can tell, really simple song, not an elaborate accompaniment. There they are at a funeral. Why this piece? Well, let's come back and look at it. So here, the words maybe might not be fully appropriate to a funeral, but later on in the poetry, you actually get reference to the conjurer goes home, which is out of stanza 4. So the conjurer's funeral is using a folk piece that's actually by a major composer that has a reference to a conjurer in it in order to sort of make the pun complete so everyone can now understand that we're being sophisticated in our cultural references. So then there's that cavalcade. So we've brought out the body and people have started coming out and they're dressed in their nice clothes and they know there's going to be cakes and ale. And what are we going to do? We're going to bring along the fiddlers. The best fiddler, in fact, is going to lead the group. And the other four fiddlers who are not as good are going to come along playing that stanza so that everybody knows that this is the conjurer at his funeral. Ha ha ha. As we go through, pull that back up into hello. Home. Yeah. Sorry, let me get back to this. There we go. Then you have the attendants coming along, carrying the body, riding on none riding on horseback, but instead riding along behind, except for Mr. George Stansfield of Sowerby, who is allowed to ride facing forward because I'm not going to tell why. That's a secret. So riding backwards is actually something you do with prisoners. You do it to shame people. It's a little bit like the Carivari that we talked about that first day, part of that folk tradition of what is going on. So why is he having everybody riding to his funeral in a shaming position? We're not going to actually address that in this piece, but it is, as you're reading through it, these little cultural moments of what's going on, keep twisting those little details. And then along comes the curate, who shall bring up the rear, dressed in his pontificalibus, dressed up in his good church clothes, and riding on a donkey, because, after all, donkeys are undignified. And this guy is not a fan of the clergy, as you shall see. So he will prepare and read the office, and then they shall pay him shillings. At the chapel, the singers should come out, and the singers should sing. And if they come out 50 yards, that is, if they come out to greet the parade, then you're going to, and if they sing the anthem, then you're going to pay them 5 shillings. And for this, we have them singing one of those sort of pompous anthems from a century before. In this case, it's by Orlando Gibbons. Oh, clap your hands together. So it's based on a psalm, being a Reformation piece. It's translated into English, and it is involved and complicated.
Oh,
about a 6-minute piece. This is not the sort of thing that you memorize and get to go out and sing in public. This is the sort of thing that you sing in the church with your music right there because it's very complicated. Each phrase is set to new music. Each voice sings independently of the others. You could hear that none of the words line up. So you have to be a really professional singer to sing this effectively. The idea that they're going to just come out of the church and stand around greeting the parade is also a little bit of a press. But we do have, back to my friend Ewan Clark, we have lovely testaments to the fact that people would go to church. They wouldn't go into church, but they would go to the church and stand outside to hear this glorious music coming out the windows. So if you don't want to be trapped by the sermon, you can still hear the choir perform, which seems to be a little bit of what this particular reference by our friend Mr. Clegg is referencing. Right. So we have then the burial and the afterwards. So I'm going to be laid down near important people in my town, and then everybody's going to go to the alehouse, which I most frequented, and eat and drink and be merry till the shot amount to 30 shillings. And the fiddlers are going to play again, the conjurer's gone home, and other tunes at their discretion, to which I leave them, and then we shall pay them the 2 shillings and 6 pence. My epitaph, which I am going to put into this newspaper publication, is going to be, "Here Conjurer Clegg, beneath the stone by his best friends was laid. Weep, O ye fiddlers, now he's gone, who loved the tweedling trade. Mourn, all ye brewers of good ale, sellers of books and news, but smile, ye jolly priests, he's pale, who grudged your power and dues." So like I said, not a fan of the clergy. Not an enthusiast. That's ironic. What was his dad? A clergyman. So what are the bequests? The bequests get sillier than the last, and I picked out two in the interest of time. I like the 45-minute sand glass, which is to remind the clergyman not to go on and on and on in those sermons. So that idea of going to the church to listen to the music instead of going to the church to be there for the 4 or 5 hour church ceremony, yeah, there's quite a bit of reference to that in this Cumberland environment, where it does seem to have been both enough religious to be baptized and follow church ceremonies and anti-religious enough to make a great deal of fun of it, particularly if you have a sibling or a parent who's serving as clergy at the time. The other one, "I give all my humility, good nature, benevolence, and hospitality with all my other good qualities whatsoever, not before disposed of, unto that person in the parish of Rochdale who can eat the most raw onions without crying." And, as if it were real, we then have the signals of authenticity, the signature, the witness, and the formulaic presentation of the date. Well, don't trust everything you read in the newspapers, but that gives you a little, so we know about sung music, we know about fiddle music, we know about our cakes and ales, and all of these are authentic practices, just maybe not turned with quite the twist that our friend, this poet, has provided in this piece of satire. Well, I remind you of that because as we get into the discussions of weddings and folk practices, satire is a strong theme in how the material is received. I have looked at 109 accounts of bidden weddings, which is the ability to consult things via database, is a fabulous thing. I love myself some deep word search, and there is a bibliography that has sort of the 18th and 19th century newspapers that the British Library puts out. So bidden weddings, they're sometimes called bride wains. A wain is a wagon. Why are they called a bride wain? Well, let me put down my foreword and tell you a moment about the bride wain. The bride wain is one of three or four things. It can be the cart that takes her goods to her husband's house. It can be the process of taking the goods to her husband's house. It can be the piece of furniture that's on the cart that is being taken to her husband's house, or it can be the wedding party. And the bride wain in Cumberland is often, in the 18th century, used as a reference to the sort of wedding and party parts of the event. In the 19th century, they get stuck on the furniture things because that's what the auction houses are trying to get rid of. So there are a whole bunch of references in the 19th century to bride wain, the chest. But we'll see sort of how the 18th century treats that. They also sometimes call them penny weddings, but penny weddings are the way in which the Scots describe these things. Remember that Cumberland is up by the Scottish border, and so the bidden wedding and the penny wedding seem to be describing the same cultural thing with two different vocabularies based on strong regional identity. And sometimes you'll also call them bidding weddings, because in having one of these weddings, you are bidding other people to attend. Just like nowadays, the bride spends a week copying out those invitations and muttering under her breath as she does so. In the 18th century, if you wanted people to attend your wedding, you had to let them know it was happening. So you could send around a series of boys to make announcements about it, or you could publish an ad in the newspaper. Well, what happens is the rest of England thinks that those northern folks are just weird. And so they like to republish the announcements in order to mock them. So it's not always very nice, but it sure is useful for the historian. So how do we know about bride wains? Well, there was this poet. John Stagg was the blind poet of Cumberland, and he published a couple of books of poetry. His first book gets picked up and reprinted a lot, and he is one of the club of dialect poems in this Cumberland environment, but he actually gets a name for himself, partly because he's blind, so everybody wants to talk about his biography, and partly because he's actually really quite a good poet. But the dialect can be really, really, really thick. So what is this? This is his poem, The Bride Wain, and he's starting out standard English version. While you're thinking about merry tales or thinking about the things going on or the guff and gurn, all of the happenings of the local village, blah, 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 things happen. First, I'll tell you the how and why, how this parlish bout, how this story began, and when and where and where they were. So what happened, where they, when it was, where they were, what they wore, and how they had this fun. First, you must know, a youthful pair, frugally thrifty, were excited to have a bride wain. And of course, they needed to invite the countryside. So, the Oxford English Dictionary likes to tell us that the word bride wain appears in English in 1804, thank you very much, which is a problem since the 1679 use of the word to help translate it into Latin would be something that maybe they overlooked. But the Oxford English Dictionary is still revising the century. They haven't gotten to it yet. So we're going to see a number of examples of the word from before the Oxford English Dictionary thinks it's an English word. Okay. So they talk about the wagon. And one of the things they do mention is something that we know from other accounts, that the spinning wheel was often at the top because you didn't want to crush it, and that to decorate it and make it clear to everybody who saw the wagon go by that it was a bride's wagon, they tie blue ribbons to the wagon wheel so that you could, to the spinning wheel, so that you could sort of celebrate and come out and cheer her on as she moved. The carved chest I've mentioned. The idea of wedding presents, and then the occasion on which these are given, this bidding wedding or bidden wedding. So Stagg is writing about a bidden wedding, and and I've given you only excerpts. This thing does go on rather a lot. But he's talking about how the couple gets the word out to all of the people in the surrounding areas. So night and day, a dozen young lads head out with nags, with their horses that are hale and hearty, so they're going to be galloping around the countryside, set off on their journey, and every lad or lass they met in the house or out of it, they told about the bride away and bade them to come on that particular day. If you look on a couple of stanzas later then, it's the whole of the countryside. They rode east and they rode west, and some rode fast and far, and some got distracted with drink, and then they could make fools of themselves, and there are a couple of stanzas talking about people who wind up in alehouses. But when they finally get the bidding done, they go home, and everyone starts getting ready for the bride wedding. So far, so good. We've invited the guests. Excuse me. Well, what we know from the newspapers is that you also might put a newspaper advertisement in. These were paid advertisements, and a number of them appear in the Cumberland Packet, which is the Cumberland Packet, if you will. The Packet is a newspaper that is serving all of the Cumberland area, nowadays modern-day Cumbria, but the northern part of Cumbria. Those people in Westmoreland are a little far out for the local invitations. And these advertisements, the first one I've been able to find so far is from 1783. These advertisements were placed by real people, and we do have some accounts from the newspaper, like historians of newspaper studies, that people would actually come to the office with their pennies to pay for the ad, and they could either provide their own advertisement, or they could hire the poet who was on the staff, who would write them a little jingly verse to advertise their wedding. And so they would have both the kind of narrative details and these little rhymey things that are telling you about what's about to happen. So, come haste to the wedding, ye friends and ye neighbors. The lovers their bliss can no longer delay. Forget all your sorrows, your cares, and your labors, and let every heart beat with pleasure that day. Come, come at my bidding to this happy wedding. It doesn't always have to rhyme really well. And revel in raptures that never can cloy. Fly, see rural felicity, who all the sweets of the wedding enjoy. And so you get then the time and the date and the names of the couple and what towns they're from and where the ceremony will be held. It is essentially your engraved wedding invitation, but instead of engraving it and passing it out individually, you're engraving it and putting it in the newspaper. So what the event was going to hold is actually a quite elaborate ceremony, and that should be comfortable to you after 5 weeks of talking about the process of a wedding is not just the thing itself, it's both the prep and the follow-up. So the early ads are in particular stressing that the nuptials will be done in due form, according to the usual rites and ceremonies. And that's a phrase that appears in multiple ads. And so it could be that they were just sort of recycling the words that they already had put together. But there does seem to be that commitment to the churchly forms and orders. What's interesting then is to think about this as part of the process of publishing your bans. The bans are supposed to be read out in the church, but now you are in this quite literate Cumberland culture also reading out the announcement of your future wedded state through newspaper advertisements, which is not something that I think they would have thought of, but it does sort of accord with this process of leading up to the wedding. The other observation is that you usually put the ad in the paper no more than 2 weeks in advance of the wedding day. So most of them are within a week, so you'll advertise and a week later it's the wedding. So not a lot of lead time for the people who are going to be coming. But you assume that the wedding couple and the family had been busy like mad because it takes a while to brew that much beer, and it is usually the family ale that is served when you get to the cake and ale part of the event. Well, no wedding is complete if you don't do a good party. And we do good parties in the 18th century. And you'll get little phrases, good entertainment is provided. We're going to have that poem that celebrates the bride herself. It may be sung, it may be just in poetry form, and there will be other ornamental parts. Presumably music, song, dancing, poetry, laughter. We then invite the attendance of his friends, he's the one who put the ad in, and all who may think it proper to honor him with their company. So this early one kind of irks me. The next one that you get published actually mentions that the bride and her friends are invited to the wedding, so sometimes you do actually get there. And the Newcastle version, so originally I was looking at it, I was like, oh look, there's one in Cumberland, and then there's one over in Newcastle, on the which is about 75 miles down the road to the east. And I thought, oh, isn't that nice? They must have friends across the border into that area. No, the Newcastle one is a week after the wedding actually happened. So they pick it up as an item of interest, not as a way of expanding the invitations to the wedding guests. Always look at your dates on these things. So here's another one. And I didn't reproduce them because they're really, really fuzzy. The scans, I mean, it's 18th century type, which is already a little grotty, scanned by people who are not Google. So it's one does have to rather peer at them. So I've done your transcriptions. So in the same general framework, you have another advertisement just a couple of years down the road. Again, the ceremony is going to be done in due form. Notice that we're starting to get our 18th century capitals. We really like all of our nouns to have capital letters. And yes, we're using the long S. And no, those do not, optical character recognition does not work well with a long S. So if you're ever interested in pursuing work on this, you have to be a little creative with how you spell things, because if you throw a random F in occasionally, you get more hits. So he would love to invite everyone personally, but time is short, so yeah, just come. So the advertisement here is in lieu of paying the printer for the cards, paying the young boys to deliver them around. Instead, everybody's getting the newspaper. Just come, right? Just come. It's going to be fun. And he would be happy. This one picks up that his bride is actually part of this event. So yes, her friends should feel free to come too. One of the things, and the little manicule there, that is from the original, pointing out that there will be a variety of sports. Too tedious to mention. In other words, the program's really full, and I don't want to pay for all of those words in the advertisement, because just then, just like now, you pay per word in your ad. So yeah, come. come. It's going to be fun. We're going to do stuff. You have to show up to find out what the stuff is. So these sorts of things get picked up like mad. And so I've done a little bit of geographical mapping. Up in the green areas, which would be Cumberland is the one to the north. That's Cumberland. That's Westmoreland. Together, they're modern-day Cumbria. You get these ads as genuine things. Like, I am going to have a wedding, and I'd really like you to come, and this is my way of doing it on the cheap. Because, after all, the reason that you have yeoman farmers is that, right, it's just poor agricultural land where the factories have moved in and tried to create this industrial environment. It's not well-to-do. It's not urban in any way. They're country folk. The people are scattered a couple of dozen kilometers away from where you are. So if you're delivering your invitations on foot, you're talking days and days to get them all out. Postal service is pretty good point-to-point with cities. If you want a letter from London to Carlisle, you can get that in about 2 days' time. But if you want to get a letter from Carlisle to Wigton, add another 2 days, and Wigton is 11 kilometers down the road, because that's not part of the infrastructure. A little bit like modern-day rural post offices. They close more often than their city counterparts. So we have some mocking versions of it. And this one of the early mocking entries is actually picked up and published in each of the different counties that are in red up here. And they talk about the actions of the great world and the little. The little world would be those like rustic folks up there up north. The great world would be the civilized parts of England, and it's a really stark distinction. In the great world, we know how to do things in a cultured way. In that little world where the rustics are, you'll find the word rustic is used impolitely. Rustic is not a flattering term. This does not mean that you've got great greenness surrounding you. It means that you are a country bumpkin. And if it were a modern day term, we'd say these are the rednecks of England. So the rustic innocence, because they are too dumb to know better, and the copy that's picked up is one out of Whitehaven, which is one of the villages. It's actually got a market, so it's fairly large. Whitehaven actually has printers, which is why they're putting these things out. In fact, my friend Ewan, the poet, has his first book published in Whitehaven. A printer in this period would produce books. They would produce chapbooks, which are sort of the cheap magazine version of books that tend to run somewhere between 8 and 24 pages. Chapbooks are great. You want to publish chapbooks because you just steal the content, you print it, and you make all the profit, and the poet gets bupkis. And so chapbooks are put out, and that same printer is also available to create posters or invitations or any of a variety of paper goods that you might need. Some of them also then pick up selling little patent medicines because it's a place where you could kind of drop in a little bit like a tobacconist's. You know, I want my tobacco and I think I'd like a can of peaches and I'd like to pick up this and that. Well, your printer is actually doing books and chapbooks and papers and medicines and a variety of pens. And if you want writing paper, you can special order it. We could do engravings. And so it's like a cottage industry. This is about 2 years before a couple of the major printers go bankrupt. So one of the reasons I think they're selling patent medicines is that the book trade isn't quite keeping them afloat. So, we are advertising to their friends of the blissful day, and there will be a variety of rural entertainments. And then we get some quoting. Such sports there will be has seldom been seen, such as wrestling and fencing and dancing between, and races for prizes for frolic and fun by horses, by asses, and dogs will be run. And so a variety of activities, and it becomes essentially your field day. You have the wedding, and that's the reason you get together. But the reason that people will come is because it's your sort of locally hosted county fair. And so, bidden to weddings, you get quite a bit of discussion. It's lower classes of peasantry. That would be yeomen who own their own land, but in a poor part of the country. The presents are made to the poor couple, and they're sort of definitionally poor because they're from Cumberland, because anyone who had any smarts would have moved to London by now. This enables them to live comfortably for the remainder of their life, not like they actually have to go out and tend to those sheep and those cattle and their the hens and bake bread and make ale. It's all just going to magically happen because we had a wedding. And it encourages matrimony. It promotes social discourse. It strengthens the nerves and the body because you do all of these athletic exercises. And it is productive of good order. So even the clergy are fans of this kind of wedding because it removes the temptations to habits of profligacy and impiety. All right, so we do have a few surviving printed invitations for forbidden weddings. The ones that I've been able to track down are all from Wales, so way down in the southern part of England. So you have sort of the two geographical outposts. If you're not London, how far away can you get from London? Wales and Cumberland, and those are the two spots that seem to hold on to this tradition the longest. This one is actually on lovely thick paper, and it's available to look at in the museum if you go to Wales. And so it is put together by Philip Lewis, who is the butcher, and Elizabeth Davies, who are inviting everyone out to this wedding. What are you going to do at a wedding? Well, almost anything goes. You put together the things that you are interested in sponsoring. So you get a variety of references. Dancing, the usual entertainments of dancing and racing. Our singing, our wrestling, our dances, our races will amply repay you the loss of your time. So yeah, come, you're gonna have fun, we're gonna do great things. I love this one, which really gives you a good set of details. A horse race and a foot race, a bull baiting, wrestling, and a bear gripping, which is imitating a bear and pretending that you are doing bear baiting, which seems to be over in the theatrical milieu. And we know that there are then masks and costumes, and they pretend to dance like bears. So you make your own entertainments. Because this is not a part of the country where the theatrical troops are coming through very often. And then again, when you're going to have races, it's always nice to know that you're in the running. And so one of the advertisements actually talks about its prizes. There's a saddle, two bridles, a pair of grand d'amour gloves that they promise will make sure that the winner gets married within the next 12 months, so the right gloves will find you love. A belt, which is again a belt of Venus, so we seem to be on the love theme, a little bit like the modern day garter, right? Who's going to catch the bouquet? Who's going to catch the garter? Who's going to win the gloves? Who's going to win the belt? You're going to get married next. You're going to be the next one throwing one of these parties. And many other articles, sports and pastimes. And again, we're back to the too numerous to mention trope. So what else? I've mentioned cakes and ale. And Sorensen quotes this particular ad, which I have not been able to find in the original form, but talks about the friends of the married couple who are treated with cold pies and ale. Cold pies is a detail that I hadn't seen elsewhere. Other people, except one place, where it talks about cold pies, frumenti, and ale. And so you do a lot of baking, you do a lot of cooking, you do a lot of ale making, and you serve up this amazing event. Frumenti is, I remember it's out of a porridge base, and you cook it, and I think, if I remember, and I'm not crossing recipes, but this is one where you essentially let it ferment. And so it's a little bit like what the Norwegians do with milk, where you cook it and cook it and cook it slow. And it essentially curdles, and then you serve up the curdles, which then are a little bit cheesy, but with like a buttermilk kind of taste to it. I think I've got the right recipe. It's one of those things where I tried a bunch of things once, and I hated it. But it gets mentioned a fair number of times. Dancing. So yes, we're going to do dancing. And the dancing, back to our friend Mr. John Stagg, writing about the dancing. While the fiddlers, their work of the leather, thrang their fiddles tuning. So we're going to have a bunch of people, they're rosling up their bows, putting rosin on them, to strike up Cuddy's wedding with glee this day. So Cuddy's wedding is a real folk song. Let me jump to Cuddy's wedding. That's this one. The only sound recording I've got is on bagpipe, not fiddle. Sorry about that. And it's just a little clip out of it because the bagpiper has put together a series of four songs. And I did not start it right. 38. Oh, no. Yes, there we go. Almost here. There. Cuddy's wedding. All right. So there we are with Cuddy's wedding, and there is everybody a-dancing. So let me cross up over into the border and look a little bit at the penny weddings. So just like the country dances that are part of our 16th century, the peasant's wedding genre, you have the 18th century penny wedding genre up in Scotland. So this is one of those recurring themes, and you get a variety of things going on in them. So in this particular instance, we'll start over here. You've got some folks doing some eating, which is cakes and ale, anybody? They brought the dogs, and in Stagg's poem, he does talk about the fact that so-and-so shows up with his dog. Dogs are invited. They're, after all, part of the family, aren't they? You also have then folks sort of in the back quaffing. You have a little bit of enthusiastic dancing going on. Dancing is for the young people. The old people sit and talk. The young people dance. Dancing takes a lot of energy, and it goes on for hours and hours. And then you've got over here a fiddler and another fiddler, and that fiddler is tippling, so the music is going to get more boisterous and more enthusiastic as the evening goes on. And then, of course, the people sitting and watching, who are mostly of the older variety. And so penny weddings as a thing. Here's another one. This is the Highland wedding. So you notice, let me back up to the previous one. You notice this one's indoors, and I forgot to mention, look at the young lad who's climbing up to the loft and the kids looking down. So barns are multi-story, and you have different things going on the two levels of the barns. And you get that both for these bidden weddings and for the other festivals and events that happen. The barn becomes a location where you have your biggest parties, and you have to be a little bit careful if you move the dancing up to the upstairs floor, because if you're too enthusiastic, you have to worry about whether the wood is sound. But it's nicer to dance on a wooden floor, so you like to have your dances upstairs when you can. It's easier on the knees, and there's more resonance when you do your kicking steps. And so those are some of the details, particularly about the other kinds of parties than weddings. Talk a lot about the space itself. So So sometimes weddings are outside if the weather's nice, like it is this morning and won't be this afternoon. You could have your dance outside. And again, you do see the details of the high foot kicking going on, hands and enthusiasm. The young girl who's not yet wearing a head covering, the older young woman who is dancing, but a little bit more demurely. And here we get a full little chamber ensemble. You get your cello and you get your violin, and they're coming as a set. And they probably came along with a dancing master to town, because dancing masters do travel around providing instruction in this period. Because after all, if you're going to be doing things involving fancy kicks like that, you kind of need some training to know how to do it and not fall over. Also here, it being a Highland wedding, you could tell it's a Highland wedding and not a Cumberland wedding, because you got your bagpiper in the back. But again, our bagpiper is not fully temperate. If you see him chugging it back, because you're paid in the beer and the food. Another penny wedding, this one by Sir David Wilkie. So this is a bit of that nostalgia genre. You're looking back on those good old times, but we're publishing the good old times advertisements in the newspapers around the same time. So talking about what they used to do in that glorious 18th century when people were good and true and innocent and rustic and stupid, and but you're at least looking back on the things our grandparents did as a sort of a genre convention. So Wilkie is, again, in a barn. This is a really messy barn. It is a really messy barn. In fact, if this were my barn, my husband and I would be having a conversation. But you've moved stuff out of the center. You got somebody in the back bringing in a chair. You got your musicians. Musicians, for whatever reason, always wind up on this side of the painting. I'll give you a hint on the internet. Sometimes they'll flip the photo, and you can often identify them because you'll find the musicians on the right, and you'll go, that looks weird. And then when you go to the museum website, there it is. There was an industry in Russia that was worried about copyright catching, and so they would just do the inverted images and put them out for sale, because when, with it inverted, there was less likelihood of getting caught. There's your internet history detail for the day. And once again, our dancers doing high steps and enthusiastic things, and then symbols of this kind of nostalgic past. So as we go through one more, Alexander Karsz is again giving us a picture of a wedding inside. It's quite dark, and you can see through the open door that it's darker in the barn than it is on the outside. So we start the party in the afternoon. The party will go all night long. And so here you have some people eating, there are our dogs again, people chit-chatting, and the dancers making their way in the middle. A close-up of a couple of details. The people doing the eating, love the guy who is cutting up the food, and this one is saying grace, and he's eating chicken on the bone. And then on the right side here, they're passing the hat. And the faces mean that maybe you aren't as enthusiastic paying for the event as you might have been. So the details of cultural practice. So yes, actually passing the hat or passing the pewter bowl or holding the pewter bowl is integral to this bidding wedding process. The bride now on a copy stool sits down in the fold, withering with pewter dibbler on her lap, on which her taufer's githering. So she sat down with a pewter bowl that is used for cleanup, and she's covered it with a cloth halfway so that people can't see what's being tossed in the bowl. So it's a form of being discreet. And she's sitting on this copper stool, and people are going to come by, and they're going to toss money in the bowl as they pass, because this is what you get out of having thrown the bidden wedding. You do all the work of throwing this really, really elaborate party, and then people pay you what they feel they can. And so this process of a bidden wedding was in part a way of establishing a new household. And in fact, we know very directly that that these events are ways of separating the young people out from their parental household. And the gifts were usually, by the later 18th century, gifts of money. In the early part of the 18th century, they could be gifts in kind. So back to our definitional idea of a bridewain, the cart going along, one of the reasons you decorated that spinning wheel with the blue ribbon was that people who wanted to give gifts could come out and they could give a hen, or they could give a little bit of fencing, or they could provide a couple of extra tools, so that the cart, as it went to the husband's house, would acquire the gifts of the neighborhood in order for the new couple to be independent and successful. So that process of taking in the money could vary. In the case of a Scottish correspondent, the bride is going around the room, kisses every man in the company, everybody puts money into a dish according to their inclination. Thus, it is that they are procuring the new couple the wherewithal to make them comfortable. So she might sit in the marketplace, that is in town, in the little town center, and people could come by, or they could sit in two chairs together and people could come around, or they could put the bowl off to the side and let people, just like the table when you get to a wedding now, you drop your card with its check inside, same exact concept. A take actually could be, it could be fairly small, it's not a well-to-do part of the countryside. Sometimes just a few guineas. Sometimes you got a lot of money. So one of the accounts actually adds to 130 pounds. So just to put that in perspective, the poet that I am working on, his annuity is 62 pounds a year. So 2 years' worth of wages to get the household set up and to provide them a means of independent livelihood. The community was invested in its young people doing well. So then what happens? Well, of course, they're going to dance. And they're going to dance and sing, and parlish dusts they had. So parlish, they're talking with one another. Those old people, they sit around and they just jabber. And the blithe young folks then, with hands clasped, are taken up into the loft. And right snug they were that night. So there's the bedding. And so we've had the announcement, we've had the procession to the household, you've had the events of the day, including the nuptial, in good form and order. You've then had the party and the food and the dancing. Now you have the bedding. They're now officially a wedded couple. And the party can continue. So the guests then, to give them some privacy, pack up. Everyone agrees, the brothers, the Brodies, the guys, the more rambunctious guys, the kinds that you don't want visiting from the other village, because they're those kinds of guys. The reveling guys decide they're all gonna go over to Lucy's. And then they're going to do country dances, and they're going to do jigs and three reels, and the fiddlers that got fuddled because the fiddlers have been quaffing, we've seen that. And actually what this means is that at the wedding, many a lad their sweethearts had in nooks and corners huddled unseen that night. So what are we going to have a few months down the road? Another wedding. So country dances, and this is what we're going to end with, country dances. Country dances are a full cultural thing. I could teach an entire class on country dances. Love this topic. Spent most of my morning cutting stuff. So Playford, the Dancing Master, which was published in the very middle of the 17th century, is where we get a lot of our information about the kind of the folk tunes of England. A lot of them are published in the book, and the very lovely frontispiece tells us a little bit about that country dancing. Here is somebody playing playing it on an instrument, and there is a gentleman with his foot in point, and there is a young lady, and they are looking at one another, and there's a crowd in the background, and it's going to be great. And so Playford is one of our big resources, and in fact, there are modern-day Playford balls, if you've ever had an opportunity. Great fun. English dancing ranges from the sedate walking to the wildly enthusiastic. And dancing masters were there back in the day to teach you how to do it. And so the dancing master in Cumberland would come through on a circuit once every 2 or 3 years, would set up in town for 3 to 4 months, would break out the fiddler, they'd set up in a tent. The young lads and young lasses would show up, they'd take off their shoes, because you don't want to get your shoes amucked. And they would learn how to do all these elaborate dances. And there was an incredible amount of choreography. And a lot of the dances are designed to be done in sets where you have multiple pairs of people doing dancing that involves elaborate shapes. You might go around and weave back in, and I'll show a couple examples. So here is The Dancing Master, a publication from 1728. You'll see the set. There they are lined up, 2 by 2 in a little group, and they are about to do some dancing. Well, this is a cultural thing. Jane Austen writes about it. Other people write about it. And I want to show you just a few clips to end. One is from a lovely film. If you haven't seen it, go see it, Becoming Jane. And there is a little excerpt of Lady Gresham's ball where they dance Hole in the Wall. This would be the sedate version. This is the cultured version. This is not the enthusiastic country bumpkins version. But it gives you a little bit of the sense of the demeanor for the early part of the evening. Then we'll move over to the schottische, which a schottische is a Scottish dance, so the schottische, which is a little bit more enthusiastic. And then we'll end with Mage on a Cree, which is also out of Playford, and will be danced by the Newcastle dancers. So here we are. Lady Gresham's Ball. So you stand still and somebody dances around you, then you get to dance and dance around them. There's a lot of flirty eye contact in English country dancing. One of the things they say, American folk dancing, it's all about the touching. English folk dancing, it's all about the looking. So the formal and refined, you learned Lady Gresham's dance. The footwork is going to be based on steps you're going to use in other dances, but you have a variety of ways that you can piece them together and a variety of shapes that can unfold over the course of the dance. And each of the dances is designed around the folk song that it's paired with. So when you say, I'm going to do Lady Gresham's dance, everybody knows that you're going to be doing the Lady Gresham dance work, so that association becomes part of how they're put together. Well, in addition to that, you have some couples dances that allow you to show off what you can do. And one of the things I had to cut was all of the writing about the very fancy footwork, because one of the phrases in Cumberland is that you are as enthusiastic as somebody with a buckle on their shoe. And so the buckle on the shoe is a reference to the fancy footwork. This gets a little flavor of that. Here we go. So a schottische, it's essentially a step, 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 hop, step, 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 hop, step, hop, step, hop, step, hop, step, hop. So you learn how to do a schottische. Like many of the couples dances, that one just repeats the steps over and over and over again. What makes you be fancy is how high you can kick your feet and what the little ornaments are. And so that was something that the couples themselves could do over time. And then the dance would end with the more enthusiastic experiences. Groups. Circle. So, from the decision to get married, through the arrival and the event, and off to the party, as your couple is fulfilling the intent of the marriage and having their bedding ceremony, the idea of the kind of sequence of events that we've been talking about has been helpful to me as a scholar as I'm thinking about what the various things mean. It's been useful to my colleagues who've come to realize, particularly in the earlier periods, that if your betrothal ceremony was really fabulous and your wedding was sort of a passing thing, and they were months or years apart from one another, that maybe we should attach those pieces that have been written for them and those depictions of the weddings more to one part of the ceremony than to the other. So it's been a great pleasure to have the chance to explore the images, the sounds, the dancing, and some of the stories about the past. It's been a joy. I have enjoyed it, and I will miss this class because it has been so much fun. Thank you. Nation wedding. Well, so one of the things, forbidden weddings, they are actually sort of the butcher class. So your mercantile class is doing bidden weddings because in 18th century England, the nobility are having the froofy weddings that are more like the ones we talked about in the Renaissance. But the idea of the destination wedding is very much in keeping with that pomp and display element that we've talked about. This idea that by showing what you can do at the moment of the wedding, you're making an assertion about power and authority in the life that you're living is, I think, part of what plays into that modern event setting. Although one of my observations is that people will invest so much in the wedding that they forget about investing in the household. And in that way, I do have a fondness for the bidden wedding because while it's a lot of fun and they have a really good time, the point of it really is to set the individuals up independently as a married couple. So I guess when it comes down to it, my sister-in-law, she rented the whole hotel. I eloped. That tells you something about a value system. So thank you very much, and look forward to seeing you in the future.